Zion Williamson was injured last night in the first minute of Duke's loss to North Carolina. It's being called a mild knee sprain, and his foot actually went through his sneaker. It was crazy to see. He will be reevaluated today, and Zion is projected by many to be the number one pick in June's draft. We're joined by FS1 college basketball analyst Jim Jackson. Good to have you with us this morning.
Morning.
What was your reaction to Zion's injury watching it?
Well, we were in studio here. Okay. So we were covering a lot of games. Yep. And when it happened, I mean, the first thing that thought in my mind, I was like, okay, his knee. But then how he fell, I thought hyperextension. And, you know, at that time, you don't want to over-evaluate, and you're just hoping that it was a mild sprain, he can get through it, which they're still trying to evaluate. But what flashed through my mind was, man, that could be serious and how it impacts him moving forward. And I think it always goes back to the question of why guys got an opportunity to leave early and do things, mm-hmm. you know, before they get hurt. But I'm just happy that it wasn't as severe as it may look. Mm-hmm. Still have to be evaluated, but that was my initial thought. Mm.
And by the way, have you seen that happen to a sneaker before?
I haven't seen a blowout, mm-hmm. but I've seen where it's ripped in the seams a little bit just because of the pressure. Now, these shoes are a lot softer, too. I mean, when I played the shoes, the leather was a little bit harder. So the stability was there. But now these shoes are like house shoes.
Interesting.
You know, with just some foam in it. So I'm not surprised that something like that with his size happened.
I was going to say, his size does play into it. Mm-hmm. As big as he mm-hmm. is, and for him to just make a little bit of a cut, and for his foot to go through the sneaker.
Oh, yeah.
I had never seen it. I've been covering sports for over 30 years. Mm-hmm. I just was shocked by it. And I was like you, hopefully this isn't something that's serious and he didn't seriously hurt himself.
I have never seen 285 pounds move with that explosive quickness before. Mm-hmm. And he tried to do sort of a reverse pivot off the dribble. And the foot goes completely through the shoe, which I'd never seen. I've seen shoes kind of blow apart, but mm-hmm. not completely through the shoe. And again, we've gone back and forth the whole show. I would shut it down right now, even if it's just tweaked, even if it's just a mild sprain, because of the style with which he plays basketball. It's too risky from here on out as the stakes rise. After you have to March 9th go to Carolina, ACC tournament, mm-hmm. NCAA's Final Four. To me, it would be too much of a threat on that knee or overcompensating and maybe hurt the other knee because he's going way up and coming way down with 285-pound shock. And I'm not going to risk that.
But, Jim, I'm saying if he's not hurt, he's 18 years old. He has a chance to win a national championship mm-hmm. with Duke, to go through, be on that big stage. I'm saying he's a kid. Most kids, when you go to play, basketball. You wouldn't have gone there if you're afraid. It's not like football where you're playing in some meaningless bowl game where your knee can get destroyed in a game that doesn't matter. Mm-hmm. You're playing for Duke. You have a chance to win a national championship. If he's healthy, I would like to see him play. I just don't shut him down just to shut him down. If he's not hurt, I don't buy into
it. Well, I'm going to push back. And the reason why, because we're older. So that was our thought process. I remember I got hurt in the Pan Am Games in 91. It wasn't even a thought about, okay, I got to get healthy so I can try to get a national championship.
And where were you at that?
I was at Ohio State. I was going into my junior year.
Junior.
Okay. And you never thought about playing,
no,
right?
Because back then you didn't think about that.
And you did you leave after?
I left after my junior year. Right. I was in the draft with Shaq and Christian Leitner, Lonzo Mourning. So I never thought about that. You never thought about if an injury happened, I don't care if you were a freshman or whatever, you thought about getting healthy, trying to get back to help your team and win a national championship. Times have changed. And I do like your point when you said this earlier today. His Zion stock rose because he wasn't projected as the number one overall pick coming in. He was not. Oh. Just like you said. Now, I'm going to give you an example. Nick Bosa shut it down, okay, because of what could happen in the future.
Well, now, football's different.
Hold on, but football's but the mindset is the same. He could have came back healthy. Yes, he could have got hurt. The way he plays, the amount of pressure that he puts on his knee, he can get hurt again, okay, doing the same thing. Another example, Kyrie Irving. Kyrie played 9 games, I think it was, maybe, or a little bit less his freshman year.
Yeah, he did. Oh,
okay? Yeah. And then he came back in the tournament. The reason why? He needed people to see him that he was healthy in order to get drafted high.
Okay.
He does it.
Well, wait a minute. So here's the other argument is, if this is how he plays and there's a chance he's a big guy and he's making these moves and blowing through sneakers, I might need to see more. I'm glad what I saw when you want to make him the number one pick. But as we move forward, is this going to be a problem? Is this going to be an issue as big as he is? So I just want to see more before I just turn over the franchise to a guy.
If you get the number one pick, you're telling me. So what I'm saying is, if you can say all that you want, but if you get the number one pick, you're picking him for a number of different reasons. One, from a marketing perspective, it's already there. Ticket sales, on the road, at home, gone. Okay, sponsorships, endorsements, all this stuff that brings the excitement to a franchise, nobody else in this draft has. Mm. Okay, so R.J. Barrett may be a little bit more talented today, Cam Reddish, but the impact on this, on what he has on the franchise, nobody else
has. I get that, but there is that, okay, when you see a crack in the armor, right, a little bit, that he could be a problem. I don't know if he doesn't play for 3 months, does he balloon to 310 pounds? I'm just asking.
Can I give you another example?
Is he not going to have to practice in a gym or do something? He might not play in a game.
Let me give you another example. Kenyon Martin, tore his knee up, still went number one.
No, I know.
Still went number one because they saw enough on him.
Sam Bowie went ahead of Michael Jordan, and what did he have?
Kenyon in his last, like, didn't he go for, when his fourth year? Or like?
Yeah, but he still went number one after having an ACL injury because they saw enough inventory and they were willing to take a chance on what they saw. And I know he's built differently. There is a concern, but I guarantee you, on draft day, whoever has that number one pick, whether he comes back or not,
that's done.
Zion Williams will be the number one pick.
I'm not disputing that a GM would have to know for sure not to take him.
Okay, here's the flip side. Mm-hmm. I have been mildly disappointed in R.J. Barrett this year, and I get you about what talent he has, but there have been too many games where I wanted him to take over late, like against Gonzaga, and he shot the ball 5 times in the last, that was in the Maui tournament, missed all 5 shots. Then last night, 37 seconds in, Zion's gone. And I'm thinking, okay, this is at Duke, this is Cameron, this is RJ's moment, or Cam Reddish, or both of them, just to say, our house, sorry, we got this. And the box score looks pretty good because RJ scored 33 and Cam 27. I can't remember a single basket either one of them scored because they all felt garbage time to me because they were never really in the game. And so when it was time for him to rise and shine and say, to make his case that he should be the number one pick, I couldn't see him last night. That's just me. I'm just eye testing it. And there have been too many times this year where I couldn't really see what he was, even though he's got that dog in him, because he will shoot it. Mm-hmm. He's not afraid of the moments and the shots. He just hasn't been closing the way I wanted to see him close as the number one overall pick.
I think the challenge is when you have a guy like R.J. Barrett, and I'm looking at it from a GM perspective, there's a lot of guys that do what he does.
He's six, seven.
I mean, in the league.
Right.
So what separates him from somebody else? I think Cam may be a little bit more talented, but the issue there is people say the motor is just not there. Mm-hmm. Now, keep in mind, North Carolina, when you shoot 74% in the paint and just dominating, the game is skewed. So no matter how many points RJ got, it still wouldn't look impactful because they were down 15, 20 points. You know what I mean? So I get your point in regards to he didn't have an impact immediately when it happened, but a lot had to do with North Carolina just balling out.
Now, here's the other part. Okay, so R.J. Barrett, right, goes to the tournament, has an unbelievable run, and I'm just going to...
Well, is he?
Where you going? Where you going, Rob?
I'm just asking. Just like you remember the call.
I can already answer. It's a no.
Okay, all right. I'm just saying, on that stage where everybody's watching, and if he's knocking down big game-winning shots, leads Duke to the championship, do you go, this guy has the moxie, he has what it takes to win on that level. He becomes a winner.
I talked to a good friend of mine who's executive in the league, and he was talking about Morant, okay? And he actually liked him as the number one pick better. I said, what if Phoenix gets it? They need a point guard.
All right.
I said, I get it, but are you going to be that GM?
I understand.
I said, it's a difference. If you're the GM that takes Zion and it doesn't work, you'd be like, okay, that's a no-brainer. If you're the GM that takes Morant and it doesn't work, it's just like, are you a fool? Okay? It's two different scenarios there by making that choice.
Mm-hmm. No, I get it. I'm not saying he shouldn't be the number one pick, but I'm giving the scenarios. If he doesn't play anymore, could something else happen? And he's going to have to play. He's going to have to practice, too, and other stuff. It's not like he can't play at all, right?
Well, it depends on if his agents, whoever he goes with, wants to do individual workouts once that time comes before the draft, okay, and a combine.
Should you not be concerned at all that this guy just blew through his sneaker and plays at that height, that weight?
I'm not concerned. When we get back the full diagnosis of what it is, if it's a sprain, stuff happens. It's like Okay. Spraining an ankle, okay? That happens. I don't care if you're 150 pounds or if you're 285. That's going to happen.
He's going to have better shoes moving forward.
I don't think so?
That's going to happen again. You're going to have to do something there. That was interesting, Jim. Thank you for joining us today. Will Lonzo Ball ever be back on the court for the Lakers? Another injury discussion. We'll tell you next.